to explain what I even mean by a Ramsey-like theorem. I'm certainly going to talk about Ramsey's theorem, that is sort of the prototypical Ramsey-like theorem, but we're going to talk about a few others as well. And then we're going to take a detour into the abstract and sort of talk about some properties that a collection of sets might have. A collection of sets might be a filter, or an ideal, or an ultrafilter, etc. I'll define all these things. Three is where the connection between two and one becomes apparent. We're going to start talking about partition properties in terms of positivity on filters, and in particular in terms of these ultrafilter things, which I will define. And then, lastly, we're going to prove some stuff. What sort of stuff, you might ask? Well, we're going to... So, a lot of you have probably seen proofs of Ramsey's theorem, especially the combinatorics people or the logic people have probably seen proofs of Ramsey's theorem. But we're going to provide an ultrafilter proof of Ramsey's theorem and ultrafilter proofs of a few other things. And I'll explain what that means. And of course, the rough idea is we're going to actually build ultrafilters that do what we want. So let's start with number one. What are some examples of Ramsey-like theorems? These are all going to have the flavor of I have some set with or without structure. I split it into some finite number of pieces. I want one of those pieces to still contain some structure. So let's start easy. So if I take the natural numbers, let's just say my natural numbers contain zero. Won't really matter for today. All that matters is that it's countably infinite. So say that I take the natural numbers and split them up into finitely many pieces. Then some piece, some pi, is infinite. Equivalently, I could say that if I take a finite union of finite sets, then their union is finite. When the problems are this easy, that's sort of obviously equivalent, but we're going to see later that those are sort of really dual notions of attacking a Ramsey-like problem. So you either talk about partition regularity of the sets that are positive, or you talk about a collection of small sets being an ideal. So the small sets in this example are the finite sets. Slightly harder. Say that I look at the collection of pairs. So this notation means the collection of unordered pairs of natural numbers. I'm going to take this and break it up into finitely many pieces. Then some pi contains a set of the form for some infinite a subset of n. So this, what I've just written down is the first non-trivial instance of Ramsey's theorem. You've probably seen it described if I take a graph, the complete graph on countably many vertices, and I color the edges of this graph in some finite number of colors, then some color class contains an infinite click. Well, this is really the same thing. So these PIs are just what color are we assigning each pair, and then this set A here would correspond to the set of vertices in our infinite click. And what we're going to see is that there's also a notion of, so this problem is sort of phrased in terms of a notion of largeness containing an infinite click like this, but it also, if you dig a little bit, there's a notion of smallness lurking here, namely collections of pairs which do not contain an infinite click are going to be small in some sense, and we're going to elaborate on this. And then let me, I'm going to just skip that example, and then let me bring up one kind of wackier example. So this is easy but different. So let's T be a tree. So what are some things I'm going to say about trees? My trees are going to have roots. They're going to be finitely branching. They're going to just keep going forever. They're going to be height omega, that's called. Every node has at least two of these successors. If you don't know what these things are, that's not a problem. I'll just describe this example in more detail. If I get there at the very end, I might not. That's okay. Picture kind of looks like this. Here's a root. Here are a finite list of immediate successors. Each of these nodes has a finite, but at least two successors, and then so on and so forth. I just do this forever. That's what a tree is for me. And then we're going to describe a Ramsey-like theorem for trees. If I write T, the finite union of sets, and some PI contains a, I'm going to put this in quotes for now, a strong subtree of T. Again, I will define strong subtree at the very end if I get there. I just want to put this example on the board now to illustrate that Ramsey-like theorems don't necessarily have to be Ramsey's theorem. They can look quite different, but they all have this flavor. Set with structure, split it up into some pieces, hope that some piece still has some structure. For those of you who are curious, this theorem is an instance of what's called the Halpern-Bleuchli theorem, which is a kind of fun partition result in set theory. So these are the sorts of problems we're going to be addressing. So with these examples floating in the back of your mind, I want to sort of disembark on some abstract stuff, which I hope isn't too tedious, but there are technical things that we will need going forward. Set. collection of subsets of X with the following properties. So that so I want some non-triviality conditions. These are going to look like this. So intuitively, as I'm writing down this definition, the filter is going to behave like the notion of largeness. So if I want to describe a notion of largeness that subsets of X might have, the whole thing had better be large. So I'm going to say that the whole thing is in fact large. If I take nothing, the empty set, that had better be small. So this should not be an F. If I take a member of F and enlarge it, so if A is large and B is bigger, B should be large also. And lastly, and this is maybe a bit less intuitive, it depends on sort of what your mental picture is, but 3, I like to think of as saying that this particular notion of largeness is like really, really large. All the sets that we're calling large are really large. What do I mean by that? So if I have 2 sets which I'm calling large, they are so large that if I intersect them, not only is it is their intersection not empty, but it is also large. It's worth noting, I'll put this in a box over here, little side. Note 3 implies the stronger looking 3 prime, where instead of intersecting 2 sets, I can say if A0, A, K minus 1 are large, then their intersection is large. So, if you have a filter as a notion of largeness, the sets in there are really, really large. In particular, if I am a set and my complement is large, then I had better be really, really small. So, there is actually, we can describe what we mean by smallness. And it is just going to be the dual of this notion of largeness. So the dual to being filtered is being an ideal. So once again, X is a non-empty set. An ideal. So similarly, it's going to be a collection of subsets of X, so that and we're just it's literally dual. So we're just going to flip all of the things that we see here. How do we do that? The whole thing is not small. The empty set is small. Subsets of small sets are small. And if I have a finite collection of small sets, their union is still small. That's the dual of 3. So I'll write it just for 2 sets. So if I have A be small, then their union is still small. And it turns out this duality between filters and ideals, it's more than just superficial. We had this intuition that if I have a filter and a set in the filter, its complement looks really, really small. And we're actually going to be able to form an ideal out of that. So just to make this duality really explicit, good things to keep in mind. If F is a filter on X, then the collection I sub F, which is defined to be all of those subsets of X whose complements are large, this is an ideal. And that's not too surprising. This act of complementation is going to switch all of the things that needed to be switched over here to get from one to the other. And similarly, every ideal gives rise to a filter in the exact same way. Similarly, if I is an ideal on X, then F sub I defined to be, it's going to be the exact same definition, really. Those subsets of X whose complements are small, then this forms a filter. So, just some abstract nonsense, but there's dual notions of large and small. And let's look at some examples. And these examples are going to be suspiciously related to the partition problems I brought up earlier. So, some examples of filters and ideals. Ideal of finite subsets of n . So this was that very first the really basic pigeonhole principle I wrote down. So if I take a finite collection of finite subsets of n, their union is still finite. That's all that this is saying. Two, this is going to be the notion of smallness related to Ramsey's theorem. So the ideal I on set bracket n squared, given by, so I'm going to set I equal to those B subsets of n squared, which don't contain an infinite clique. And I can say that, so there does not exist an infinite A subset of N, so that bracket A squared is a subset of B. And then three, there's going to be a similar notion for that third partition problem that I brought up. So if T is a tree, then the collection of, if I set I to be the ideal of subsets of the tree so that there does not exist subtree S with S as subtree A. Of course, for 2 and 3 to really be examples of ideals, you have to know that the partition theorems I was telling you about are true, or you have to take that at face value. So until we know that, we don't really know that 2 and 3 are ideals yet. One is sort of obvious. We're gonna take one at face value. So this suggests, let me decide how I want to proceed. I'm going to hold off on defining ultrafilters. So I think I'm going to talk about positivity. So filters give us notions of largeness. Sesson filters are huge. And then if you're in the dual ideal, you're really small. So what does medium mean? So there's a nice in-between notion, which is called positivity, and it's with respect to a filter or an ideal, and things with definition. I'll phrase it with respect to a filter. Let F be a filter on X. We say a subset of X is F positive if and only if X less A is not large. Equivalently, you can form that dual ideal to the filter. I'll write this out explicitly. Equivalently, A is not a member of the dual ideal. So, positive sets are just those things which don't have to be small. If F is a filter and I'm a subset in the dual ideal, I am sort of certified as being a very small subset because my complement is in that filter. My complement was declared to be big. I can't possibly be large in any sense. Let me expand on this intuition. So here's a remark. And what this remark serves to do is the F positive sets, so while positive sets aren't necessarily large, they're sets that could become large. And I mean that in the following sense. Remark. A is F positive if and only if I can take the filter, and then I take all the sets of this form, A intersect B, for B in the filter, if this is a filter. So this says that A is F positive. A might not be an F, but there is some larger filter extending F which does contain A. So I can make A large by changing my notion of largeness. Let me, so we're about to get into the discussion of partition regularity. And the key intuition is that collections of sets which are partition regular sort of behave like the collection of positive sets or something. So let me tell you how the collection of positive sets for a filter behaves. Let's give it some notation. So F plus, I'm going to define that to be the positive sets. quick proposition. Let A be F positive and write A as a finite union of some of sets. Then some PI is F positive. So this looks eerily like those combinatorial problems we were thinking about at the very beginning. A set with some property, we split it up, we want one of the pieces to have the property. So this is sort of the abstract notion that's going to unify all these problems, the notion of positivity with respect to a filter. And in this level of abstraction, this proposition is just obvious. Why? Because the proof is just consider the dual ideal. If none of the PIs were F positive, that's exactly saying that all of the PIs are in the ideal. A finite union of small things is still small. But I told you that A wasn't small because A was F positive. So that can't happen. And positive sets for filters have this nice property. So what is this nice property? Let's abstract that out of this. So we're going to sort of abstract this partition regularity property, and then we're going to see that it's not much of an abstraction at all. And I might actually modify something in my notes. So definition. Let's R be a subset of R sub X. For X, a non-empty set. I am going to change what I'm doing. So if I make some mistakes, it's because I'm changing things right now. So I was going to define what partition regular means. I'm actually going to define weakly partition regular, because that's going to be a little bit more transparent for the applications we have in mind. Weakly partition regular if whenever I take X and I break it up into some pieces, finitely many, then some PI contains a subset in R. So what I mean explicitly, i.e. some B, a subset of PI with B in R. So this is abstracting away exactly what we want. We have these combinatorial problems, so we're just investigating, well, what types of collections of sets solve, or for what sorts of collections of sets is the problem we're worried about true? And I'm going to give a list of examples. Once again, all very suspiciously related to the examples from the beginning. So, one. And a lot of these are, in fact, going to be stronger than just weakly. They're going to be partition regular. The difference is I replace, to go from weakly to just full partition regular, I replace X here with any member of R. So a small difference, but it's a little annoying to have to shrink down to a member of R and then prove the thing every single time. So I'm not going to do it. So one, R subset of power 7n, given by the infinite sets. The collection of infinite sets is partition regular. If I take the natural numbers, split it into finitely many pieces, some piece has to be infinite. This is the partition regular family corresponding to Ramsey's theorem. R subset of power set of bracket n squared given by from the set R equal to this is going to be the collection of infinite clicks. And then, likewise, we have R subset of, let me actually preface this, if T is a tree, then let R subset of the power set of T be a collection of strong subtrees. So partition regularity really captures exactly what we're looking for in all of these problems.
And all of these are classes of F positive sets, right? Or are they
for some, yes, this is so what we need to do now is so we arrived at this notion of partition regularity by thinking about positivity.
Right.
So now we need to go back. We need to describe some filter for which this is.
Is that always the case?
Yes. This is what we're gonna
what about,
right now.
Wait. I feel like the singleton containing only the empty set is weakly partition regular.
The singleton containing
because
only...
Because if you decompose a set, then the empty set is a subset.
Well, let me... You're absolutely right. empty is never in a weakly partition regular.
Okay. And does that fix it?
Yes.
Okay.
Dang logicians. So this is exactly our goal now. We want to get back to the land of filters. And here's where it turns out some filters are better to think about than others. This is where the ultrafilter comes in. So we need a tiny bit more abstract nonsense, and then we're going to do some cool things. A filter. One second. A filter U subset of power set of some set X. X is a non-empty set. Maximal just literally means under set inclusion. So I'm going to say that a filter F might be a subset of a filter G if every set in F, every set that is F large is also G large. And why do maximal filters exist? This is our friend Zorn. So Zorn's lemma tells us that these maximal filters, we can get our hands on them. You do need a little bit of, you can't exhibit an ultrafilter. You need some amount of choice. characterization of ultrafilters. I mean, because I'm not going to grab a filter and ask, is this an ultrafilter? Let's look at all the collections larger than it and see if any of those are filters. That's a really silly way of trying to verify that something's an ultrafilter. Luckily, there's an easy way. So equivalently, U is an ultrafilter if and only if U is a filter and whenever I take, if I write the whole set as either A, let's say that I write the whole thing as a disjoint union of two pieces. Then one of the pieces is in U. And so we had those conditions 1, 2, and 3 for being a filter. So think of this as item number 4 to get an ultrafilter. And this is going to be equivalent to, I'm going to write down a superficially stronger 4 prime. Which is also always going to be true. So whenever A is a member, so there's two strengthenings. I'm not going to start with the whole thing X. I'm going to start with just any member of U. I'm also going to allow not just two pieces, but finitely many pieces. A0. Then some. AI is in U. A third characterization of this ultraness is also really useful to keep in mind. Equivalently, this is a pretty easy consequence of 4 and 4 prime. Equivalently, U is ultra if U, in fact, this is a direct consequence of 4 as written there. If U equals U plus. So there's no notion of medium for ultrafilters. Every set with respect to an ultrafilter is either large or small. And that's exactly what 4 says here. If A is not in U, then B had to be in U. So there's no getting away with medium. You have to be large or small with ultrafilters. And now, I believe, let me just check something. Here's a remark that's going to be really useful. So it's related to this Zorn thing again. So using Zorn's lemma. So, we don't just have to grab ultrafilters out of the blue. We can be a little bit clever when choosing our ultrafilters. In particular, any filter can be extended to a maximal ultrafilter, or to an ultrafilter. Can be extended to an ultrafilter. So then just some terminology. So if I is an ideal and the ultrafilter U extends the dual filter of I, I'll say that U avoids I. Given any notion of smallness, I can cook up a maximal notion of largeness which doesn't disagree with that previous notion of smallness.
What's the intuition behind avoiding?
Oh, you don't want, I do not want, sorry, I want to avoid placing members of I in the ultrafilter.
Okay.
So with that, I think we're ready for the key theorem. Let's get that annoying empty set case out of the way. Then the following are equivalent. One, R is partition regular. Weakly partition regular. I changed that. Weakly partition regular. And two, there is ultrafilter U on X avoiding, oh no, that's the proof. There is an ultrafilter U on X with every element of the ultrafilter containing subset R. And this theorem is actually not hard to prove at all. So proof, 1 implies 2. So if R is partition regular, let I sub R be the collection of those sets. This is the annoyance with weakly versus honest partition regular. So this is going to be IR prime. Then let I R be the collection of finite unions of members. By weak partition regularity, this collection I sub R is an idea. That was exactly, did I leave the definition of weakly PR on the board? I did not. But let's think it through. I take my set X, I break it up, let me phrase it this way. Say that IR was not an ideal. What would have to go wrong? That would mean that there's some finite list of members of IR prime whose union is the whole thing, X. So So I've written X as a finite union of pieces, supposedly none of which contain a member of R. But R is partition regular, weakly partition regular, which means exactly the opposite. Whenever I take X, break it into finitely many pieces, some piece contains a member of R. So it would help if I kept the definition of weak PR on the board, but this is just definition unfolding. And then not one implies not two. Let's say suppose not. Suppose R is not PR. This means, so we can write X as a finite union of pieces with no PI containing a member of R. But now we have no hope at building an ultrafilter as a number two because of 4 prime. Any ultrafilter on X contains one of these pieces, and any one of those pieces is a certificate that U does not behave like this. U contains a subset, or contains a set, no subsets of which are in R. And that's a problem. So this was the key idea. This really connects weak partition regularity and ultrafiltered. What it means for us, I think I have enough time to cover the Ramsey theory example. I don't think I'll get to the tree example, but I will try my best. So remember our goals. We had 1, 2, 3, which was technical stuff, and then 4 was prove some stuff. We're going to prove some stuff. So we can prove Ramsey-like theorems by exhibiting ultrafilters with certain properties. And let me show you what I mean by this by proving Ramsey's theorem. And to do that, I need... So we need methods of constructing ultrafilters, not directly, of course, because ultrafilters are these kind of ethereal objects, you need choice, etc. But if I have my hands on one ultrafilter, can I cook up a more interesting ultrafilter? That's the theme of these constructions. So the construction that's going to come into play in proving Ramsey's theorem is the tensor product of 2 ultrafilters. So let X and Y be non-empty sets. Let U be in... I didn't define this. Beta X is the set of all ultrafilters on X. So if I have U and beta X, V and beta Y, their tensor product, U tensor V, this is going to be an ultrafilter on X cross Y, is defined I have a subset of the product, and when am I going to declare that it is large? I'm going to do so if, and I'm going to use this ultrafilter quantifier notation. I'll write it down and explain with a picture. So for U many little x's in X, there are V many computation. So here's the product. The products look like squares. Here's x, here's y. And let's zoom in on a particular x0 over here. X0 is a member of x. And I'm going to look at this fiber above x0. And a is a subset of the product. A kind of looks like this. Here's a. So a sub x0, x0 looks up and thinks that these members of y are good for getting into a. X1 over here, another member of x, looks up and thinks that these members of y are good for getting into A. So now, some x's might be very sad. This one's very sad. It didn't see any members of A. But some of them might have seen so many members of A that we might be able to write something like this. We might be able to say that those y and y, for which x0, y is an A, it might be large. It might be in V. And so if this happens, I'm going to say that x0 is good for A. And then we might just be so lucky that there are so many x0s, or so many little x's that are good for A, that the collection of x's that are good for A is a large subset of x. It's a member of U. And so that's exactly what this tensor product is describing. It says for lots and lots of little x's, there are lots and lots of little y's that give us. It is, yeah. The beta compactification of a discrete space is the space of ultrafilters. For other spaces, it's weird, but any other questions, especially about the construction? We're going to use it to prove Ramsey's theorem. So what we're going to do, so goal, is construct an ultrafilter on the set of pairs of natural numbers so that every A, let me use B instead, B and U contains an infinite click. If I can do this, then by our theorem, we're done. We have proved Ramsey's theorem. And we're going to do this by looking at tensor products. So step one, pick any non-principal. I'll explain what non-principal means in a bit. U in beta n. This is going to get us started. Non-principal means just in terms of that vocabulary of avoidance of ideals, it just means that U avoids the finite ideal. U contains no finite sets. So every large set is infinite. Step two. We're going to form a tensor product. Form U tensor U.
I'm sorry, another question.
Okay.
So forming a tensor product, the filters, does it have to be ultrafilters?
you can form the tensor product of two filters. That's certainly something that's good to do. But what's nice about doing it with ultrafilters is exactly that we get an ultrafilter when we do it. So something might look a little fishy because this is not really on bracket n squared. This really, if we're being honest, it lives in beta n cross n, superficially different object. The first thing we're going to do is let's convince ourselves that this really lives here. So, lemma, the collection of little m, with m less than n, is in u cross u. And the proof is really easy. The proof is I'm going to draw a rectangle. So here's n, here's n. Here is the equality, the diagonal. And now how many, so m, this is exactly the top. The second question is all the stuff up here. And I want to show that this is large with respect to u cross u. Well, we know that u was non-principal. So if I look at any point here, and I look at the line above it, how many, so this is some little m, how many n's work to get little m into the set? Well, almost all of them. Whenever n is bigger than m, it's gonna work. And we know that u is non-principal, so it doesn't contain this finite initial segment, so it has to have contained the rest of everything. So it turns out every point down here works. And ultrafilters contain all of them. So that's proof by picture. And so now we can make, this allows us to make an identification. I'm going to identify a pair of natural numbers with this ordered pair here. So just the pair mn with m less than n is going to play the role of the pair, the unordered pair mn. And now we're ready to actually show that this works. And I'm going to do this kind of carefully, because I definitely don't have time for the tree example. So I'm just going to do this example really carefully. Oh, I need a new page. Yes, here we go. So we need to show that every U tensor U large set contains an infinite clique. So let B be in U tensor U. So we need to, the first thing we kind of have to do, all of these proofs have a similar flavor, we need to unfold this definition. That's a pretty bundled up definition. So I'm going to let B sub little u equal those m, so that the collection of m with m, n in B is in U. So drawing that square again, little b sub u is all the points on the bottom whose fiber above that point hits b lots of times. Now, by definition of tensor product, u tensor u, B sub u is in u. Because that's just what it means for membership in u tensor. of n0 to be those n, so that n0n is in B. So what does it mean to be in B sub U? It means that this is in U. So this is in U. So this is in U. This is in U. Let's intersect them. Their intersection is in U. So B sub N0 intersect B sub U is in U. And I'm going to pick N1. N1 from this set. So notice, first of all, the first thing we should notice is that the pair N0 and 1 is in B. Why? Because N sub 1 is in B N sub 0. And that means exactly this. N sub 0, N sub 1 is in B. What we do at stage K be a little informal, but the idea is clear at this point. At stage K, what do we need to do? We need to pick, we're going to pick N sub K, a member of the set B sub U. Membership in B sub U is what allows us to keep going. It had better, N0 and K had better be in B, and 1 and K had better be in B, all the way up to N sub K minus 1. N sub K minus 1 and K had better be in B. Why is this possible? Well, this is just a finite intersection of large sets. So we can do that. Finite intersections of large sets are still U large. And so then, at the very end, the collection N sub K, K and N are the vertices of the desired. So I think that's all I have time for today. So any questions? Joe.
So this is quite amazing. It feels like you're proving infinite Ramsey with only a single pass through the vertices.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow
exactly. The ultrafilter tells you, the ultrafilter navigates for you.
Right. So I have to ask, is there a known proof of finite Ramsey using some finitary equivalent of?
Ooh, I'm gonna say no. We really needed the non-principality to do anything. So the moment we're talking about finite sets, ultrafilters on finite sets are really boring. They're all principal. So this really is some extra machinery that we're using. Oh, Jeff.
Is there an ultrafilter proof of the general Halpern-Loeche theorem?
That is what I was working on all winter break. So I have something for dimension 2. I can't get higher. The one for dimension 1 is pretty fun though, and not too hard. Okay. side. So Ramsey's theorem, Ramsey proved his theorem for not just coloring the pairs. You can color the triples, you can color the k-tuples, what have you. What do you need to do to generalize this sort of machinery? You just form the, let's say for three, you form the threefold tensor product of your favorite non-principal ultrafilter. Same idea for most x-coordinates, there are most y-coordinates, so that for most z-coordinates, you're large, that's an ultrafilter, that's a